second part of our confirmation class lesson one video. There's a lot of information to take in. So we talked about what the Bible is, and we talked about the books of the Bible, and how the Bible comes to us as communication from God. But there are a few things that we want to pay attention to about the Bible. So the reason behind me sharing all that information and doing these videos is because I want you guys to become people who love the Bible, to become people who recognize the Bible for the value that it, the ultimate value that it has, and to allow it to change your heart. And what I want you guys to develop is a deep, serious appreciation for a couple things. For one, the uniqueness of the Bible, for its authorship, for the authority which it speaks, and its purpose. When we talk about the uniqueness of the Bible, lies in the fact that it is a supernatural book, that this book is different from all other books that have ever been written, that this book makes the claim that it is the very words of the creator of everything. And as it is as we take it as deathly serious, as the words that come from God, it comes to us with this first point about its uniqueness that I want you to take in. It comes to us with authority. And its authority comes to us and demands obedience from us, demands repentance from us. It demonstrates God's credibility and lets us know that it is all sufficient for everything that we need to live a life in relationship to God, this Christian life. And it also demands exclusive allegiance from us. So God's word demands great obedience. 1 Samuel, there's this scene where God says that I desire obedience rather than sacrifice. I desire obedience from the heart. And that's what God wants. He desires for truth to be implanted into our hearts. And that's a part of this authority thing, that it comes to us demanding that we allow his truth to come into our hearts and allow that to cause us to obey him. He demands repentance. Repentance is just, all repentance means is to turn. It most of the time when you see this word in scripture, it's referring to a change of mind that happens. Ultimately, we know that it's a change of heart that God gives us, that allows us to see our sin and for what it is and reject it, and to run towards God, who we know is our greatest good. And for us as Christians, repentance involves us, when we sin, to make a plan to not do that again, because we don't desire to abide or to live in sin. And then the Bible demonstrates credibility. It lets us know that this is the very word of God, and that it's all sufficient. Everything that we need to know what we are to believe about God, and also to what God requires of us, what duty he requires of us. And also the Bible finally demands exclusive allegiance. At his temptation in Matthew chapter 4, we look at verse 10, and Jesus, after Satan comes to him with his temptation to bow down to him, Jesus says this. He's like, "Get thee behind me, Satan," or "Get away from me, Satan." Here's why. He says, because, he quotes Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 13. And he says, because You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. And I'll give it a little, another little note on authority. So when the Bible talks about authority, it's talking about the fact that because God made us, he has some claim over our life and how we live it. And when the Bible speaks to us, it speaks to us with a force that has a claim on us, right? With a force that demands obedience from us. Like, but it's authoritative in that it's trustworthy, that we can trust that this the word of God is seeking our good for his glory. And those things come to give us this appreciation, these safety nets that we can actually trust God in his word, and also these boundaries that we kind of stay in, that they keep us on the track of a relationship with him. And then we recognize that the Bible is flawless. When we talk about the Bible's flawlessness, we're talking about this thing called inerrancy, or the fact that in its original forms, as God communicated it, the Bible's without error. And as we go through as we talk about the inerrancy of Scripture, there are a few things that we want to make note of. God's word does leave us with some puzzles. There are some secret things that do belong to God, and there are some paradoxes that we find in Scripture. But I've never found a contradiction in Scripture. There have been times where I thought I did, but after agonizing and crying and studying some more, that's kind of what causes me to dig deep a lot of times, because I understand how much I don't know instead of thinking that I know everything. Every time that I've dug back and looked back at a paradox that came up, I was like, oh, you know, once I thought about it, once I either looked up the definitions of the words or found what it actually said or meant, it always turned out to be solid. So the word is flawless in those respects, but there are things that come to puzzle us. But what I would encourage you to do is that when there's something that comes to puzzle you, don't get frustrated and just go throw in the towel, but dig, study the word of God, become a student who learns how to use the Bible rightly. And I always see that, I see those paradoxes or those puzzles as invitation from God for deeper conversation with him, or for deeper, to dig deeper for insight. So God's word does leave us with some puzzles, but the Scriptures come to us with this internal witness, that is this supernatural quality that they have that speaks to our hearts and bears witness with our hearts that these words are from God. Furthermore, God's word abides forever. You haven't ever passed away, but not one jot or tittle, one little dot that is a part of a letter will pass away from this word. And finally, talking about the Bible's flawlessness, we recognize that as the Bible comes to us from Creator, from God who is good, the Bible bears witness about God that he cannot lie. And that gives me so much peace to know that I can fully trust and thrust myself on God, that even when he says something that I don't understand, that I know that he's not going to lie to me. We recognize that the God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. And finally, the Bible, the word of God, is inspired. It speaks of this this fact that God breathed out this word, as 1 Timothy lets us know. Some portions of the Word of God were written with God's very finger. When God gave his word to Moses, that he wrote those things in Exodus, he wrote it with his own finger, as a record of God's own words. Several times throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Old Testament first, primarily, you have God telling Moses, write these things down. He tells Joshua, write these things down. He tells Isaiah, he's like, hey, go get a stone tablet and write these things down so that they can be preserved for future generations. And so we have those coming to us. It's a record of his own words. He wanted those preserved for us. And it's internally consistent. This idea of the Bible being internally consistent deals with this principle that I want you guys to write down on your hearts about biblical interpretation. And the very first principle of biblical interpretation is that Scripture interprets Scripture, and that there is no contradiction within the Bible. So if you see something in the Bible and you're new to it and you think it means one thing, look for other scriptures that talk about that same topic to kind of give you the full scope of the picture that God is painting, so that you don't just get a fragmented picture or take something and misunderstand it. So you want to use the whole Bible to interpret the whole Bible. And the Bible doesn't contradict itself. And also that God's promises never fail. That as God speaks his word to us in its uniqueness, his promises never fail. We've talked about the Bible and its uniqueness, using its authorship, knowing that the Bible comes to us from God himself, that he breathed these things out. As 1 Timothy 3:16 lets us know that all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for training, for reproof, and for instruction in godliness, so that the person of man of God, or the person of God, may be completely prepared, right? Completely prepared for every good work. The Bible speaks with authority, the Bible is flawless, and the Bible is inspired by God. It's and the idea of inspiration, I'll unpack that just a little bit more. The idea is that it's not that these guys were sitting in some type of trance and God had them, was controlling their hands and controlling their minds. But the idea of inspiration is that God, the Holy Spirit, taking the information that the Father spoke and using these prophets' intellect, using their personalities, using their background and education, he was able to convey the very message that God wanted to convey through them, through his God power. He got the message that God wanted to get to us, using all those things. So then we want to talk about the unity of the Bible, the unity of the Scriptures. So we believe that the Bible is a lot of books and telling one unified story. But the authors of the Bible, the message of the Bible is uniform, despite these 42 authors being separated by 1,500 years of time and being in, on three different continents, different geographical locations, and also speaking different languages and writing in different languages, they still came out with the same message, that the fullness of salvation is revealed in the Old Testament, and that the prophets predict Christ and his suffering, the culmination of God's work in human history, and that Jesus himself affirmed the unity of the Scriptures, that Jesus himself let us know that all the scriptures were talking about him. He was talking to a group of religious leaders in Israel. In their argument, he says this to them. He says, "You search the scriptures because you believe that in them you have eternal life. You believe that just because you have the Bible, that God's spoken to you, you have eternal life." He's saying, but no, guys, the Bible's talking about me. And later on in John chapter 17, Jesus says in his prayer that this is eternal life, that they may know you, the one true God, and me, Jesus Christ, whom you sent. That is mind-boggling. So the scriptures, Jesus affirmed that the unity of the scriptures, but the thread that runs all throughout scriptures, that is the biggest point of unity, is that all of the Bible is talking about Jesus. All throughout the Bible, from Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, all the way to Revelation, there are these allusions to Christ. There are these pictures, these appearances, these prophecies that were all pointing towards Jesus. God gives this promise to Abraham that he would allow his family to be a blessing, that through his seed, singular, one seed, this one person, all nations of the earth will be blessed. And then it's talking about Jesus. And you can go, I can go on and on. The whole thing talks about Jesus and what he would do. And another thing that is unifying in the Bible is that this concept of covenant, and all the covenant is just an agreement. It's kind of like a legal agreement of love, though. It's a legal agreement to seek the good of the other party over and above your own well-being, right? And God sets that up in Genesis with Abraham, and he runs that through the entire Bible, this concept of covenant. The Old and New Testament, we call them Old and New because we're referring to the Old Covenant and the New Covenant that the Scriptures speak of in Christ. That we are, that the Old Covenant is in the Old Testament was kind of like to watch over humanity until Jesus got here to give us the covenant of grace that we now stand under. The law still, still speaks with force. I want to talk about the purpose of the Bible. I want you to take a second and write down why you think God gave us the Bible. What is the purpose of the Bible? The purpose of the Bible is that second catechism question. What rule has God given us to direct us how we may glorify and enjoy Him? Purpose of the Bible is to help us to fulfill our purpose. And that's the first catechism question. What is the chief end of man? The chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. The second catechism question, the answer to that is God gave us the Word of God, which contains the scriptures of the Old and New Testament, the Old and New Testament, and those are the only singular, our only allegiance. Those are the only means that we have to direct us in how we are to glorify God. And what do the scriptures principally teach? The third catechism question. The scriptures principally teach what man is to believe about God, or telling us who God is, what he's like, and what our duty is. So what duty God requires of man. Who God is, what he's like, and in light of recognizing that God is sovereign creator, we are responsible creation. We are responsible for it to act, to obey here on earth. And so that's the purpose of the Bible. So I want to read this confession statement real quick. And this statement comes from the Westminster Confession of Faith. I was going to pick up the copy real quick. But the Bible speaks, this is what it says, the Bible speaks authoritatively and so deserves to be believed and obeyed. This authority does not depend on the testimony of any man, church, or man or church, but completely on God, its author, who himself is truth. Who is himself truth. The Bible, therefore, is to be accepted as true because it is the word of God. God reveals himself, he communicates about himself in revelation, general revelation, special revelation. When we look at Psalm 19, it lets us know that God created the heavens and the earth. I hope that from this lesson, you will be inspired to go and spend time with God in his word. I don't want you to just memorize facts, but I want you to become, allow this to soak into your heart and to become someone who is in love with these scriptures, who is in love